So we're now in the chapel. The chapel is vital in any tower, any castle, anywhere, especially in these times and the times that led up to now. You see, many of the wars that were going on outside the walls, or the things that were causing the wars, basically came down to religion and who controlled the church. So the church was also social media. It was your newspaper. What the church said goes. So whoever held, it wasn't just like a kingship, because though a kingship gave you a connection to God, nothing's higher than God itself. And that's why whichever religion was in power was truly formidable and controlled everything else, financial sectors, whatever else you could wish to control. So the chapel was an essential part of the building, as religion was an important part of daily life. The lord of the castle would have visited the chapel every day. I mean, not this would have been, obviously, the privileged would have had their chapel, their services first, and so on and so on. The entrance you have just used did not exist until later in the castle's history. In earlier times, there was a sedile, a stone seat. The entrance you have just used did not set in the wall where the priest could sit. The original entrance was through the arch at the far end, now barred, that leads to the great hall. This was the original entrance. This is the level of the state apartments. Here the cross wall is replaced by an arcade of magnificent columns and supporting arches which separate the great hall from the great chamber beyond. For most of the time, the larger arches were blocked off by wooden, later stone, partitions. These rooms would have been the most luxurious in the keep, representing the height of a good living for the period. Today we can only imagine the trappings of wealth that would have graced this room when a feast or ceremony took place. The hall would have been full of people dressed in their finest clothes, and the walls would have been covered with decorative hangings, which would have been right here. Obviously, there's no floor there now. There's that wind again. Look at that centre, Al. Look how old the centre is. Mm. Like.
The stonemasonry is ancient.
Yeah. I wonder where the well is. Come on. Watch your step, Al. There's a lot of uneven stairs here. This was just for looking down on the Great Hall. And here we can see a picture of what it might have looked like with a huge fire right there. And there's the beautiful fireplace. Look at that. There it is. See it? Come over here a bit and get that fireplace. We'll be able to look at it from a better angle anyway. So your benches and that would have been right here. Bustling, bustling, busy, busy life. Now it's barren.
Shall we continue the ascent, sir?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. just that spooky. This view here. That's a very dangerous little bit there. So, this is a clear reminder. You still filming, cameraman?
Yeah.
This little gap here is a clear reminder of just how dark castles were without lanterns. Because look, here we go. Can you even see me? Very vaguely. But at night this would have been pitch black. As I was saying, it could be new, it could be old, that looks relatively new. But you don't know, that could be old there. That could be carved in. See it? The wind out there is mental, I tell you. So here, you can see where these stairs are far too damaged. I'll get my light out and see if you can see them, but I can see they're wrecked from here. Come here, cameraman. Stand up nice and tall there. Stay up there and hold the camera up and see. I don't think my light's really going to catch it, but I can see they're wrecked. These are quite damaged here. You can see all here. They've faded over the centuries.
Death trap. You don't have your wits about you.
Yes, so have your wits about you. Look at this, cameraman. Every different view I find amazing. Siege defense. Okay. The broken arch above you. On the opposite wall is a clue to a violent period in the castle's history. Oh, yeah, this is it talking about. Okay. So from the inside view, you can see, I know what this is going to say. There, you can see clearly that split, that's the new build. That came in when the castle was restored. And there you can see that was the arch of the previous window where the rebels were looking out onto King John, which faced that way because the cathedral's over there. So they dug underneath, they undermined and brought that whole thing crashing down. So if you was over this side, you'd have just heard an almighty Armageddon-like sound that must have sounded like God's wrath. Obviously this would have been, there's a lot of holes here because it faces the water, because most of the attacks you'd expect would come from the water. So that's where they expect to defend the most. The other side was fortified with walls. Now this castle also come up in the story of Henry VIII's detest for Catholicism, which we'll talk about in just a moment. This isn't the place you want to fall over. Murderer of all things shins. once again supporting my what I said about how you are in bowshot if you are at the front of the cathedral there to the arches here. Now, just out of sight, you can't see it from here, but on the river is actually a Russian submarine from the Cold War. But all of those living accommodations and everything out there would have very quickly become the property of King John when he was there. And as I mentioned before, the Magna Carta, which a lot of people bang on about today, was actually created by those that stood against royalist rule, who were tired of the taxes and levies put on them so that their king could go to war. But there's also the case of serfdom, and this is how they talked a lot of the peasants into it, because serfdom basically meant the lord of the manor was your everything. You became a skivvy. It was
sovereign,
like
de facto.
It was like paternalism. You was by contract owned by the lord of the land, and it was very easy therefore for the gentrified classes to persuade them that it was far better for them to work with them than to continue under loyalist reign. This is fascinating. This is particularly interesting here. You can see now we're now entering one of the four main sentry towers. We're still indoors at this moment, so we're in one of the squared towers. But here, right here, is the full evidence that if you was a bowman and you saw any of John's men, you'd be going for him.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
You'd have a direct line of sight as well.
There's the sub. Look, there's the sub. Come here, cameraman. So you can see out there, I don't know how well the camera can see it, but that is a U-boat, or submarine rather. Anyway, let's go. And here we are, through the eyes of the soldiers. Here we are, the round tower. This is it. Now, this castle was also taken in the year 1648, but without a fight, by the rebels who were unhappy about King Henry VIII's decision to end Catholic power and to turn against the papacy, e.g. the Pope. Now, this would see the Bishop of Canterbury turn up with his own men and men that he convinced and take this property. But Henry VIII's forces were adamant to take it back because of what it represents. Wouldn't you agree, Al?
Yes. So the fortress, since its construction and its earliest beginnings, was a bastion of clerical, monarchical, and mercantile power for both Kent and the surrounding areas. The Archbishop of Canterbury knew that it would be a seat of religious Catholic power that he might be able to maintain and retain over time. Unfortunately, that was not the case, as Henry VIII wanted it as a bastion for his own power, and, of course, he expelled the Catholics from this here domain who had taken it. In the year 1648, after they tried to overthrow the king due to his opposition to the Catholic Church and the papal edicts that were designated as God's word on earth, Henry VIII opposed this, and therefore the Archbishop of Canterbury, who was a Catholic, wanted to oppose the king for going against his power, authority, influence, etc. This here is the circular tower.
Yeah, if you look up, cameraman, this is the circular tower, which was destroyed, yeah.
damages and necessary reconstruction costs.
Yeah, this is the Mound Tower. But now what we're going to do is we're going to walk all the way around and show you why this place is so important militarily. Come with me. And it's bloody freezing up here, I'll let you know. Danger, keep off netting. Jesus. Glorious image of the cathedral from here. Absolutely glorious. So we can't get into that tower, unfortunately, over there for some reason. And this is some genuine interesting graffiti. I saw a load over there. I think we're going to have to go back and look at it. I don't like the term graffiti because I detest modern actual graffiti, but this is different. And bear in mind, with a castle which is, you know, 1,000 years old, and a location which is older, you've had centuries of important, influential people here. So you don't know if it's an archer, or it's an influential lord who's decided to come up and grave something here, or you don't know if it's some local 18-year-old. But I'm sure that things like this are a little bit more interesting than a bit of ugly graffiti on the wall. So if we look out this window, we now see why the location is so important. Because it's on a curve on the river Medway. And militarily, this is where you would have to travel to get to London. You would have to pass here. So if you was coming in at Dover, you would have to get past the first defence, then you'd have to get past here, and then you'd have to face them in London. So this was a vital halfway point between the two, and that's why militarily, and obviously for prestigious reasons, it's vital to hold this. Now, another interesting fact is, throughout certain centuries, the archers, they were okay, but crossbowmen were actually looked down on. Because crossbowmen, you would get the lower classes who could suddenly kill a knight who was wearing a huge, expensive suit of armour.
Heraldry plate mail.
Yeah, so basically. So there was actually it was seen as bad form to use a crossbow. It was seen as cheating. But eventually that went to the wayside in the days of cannon and all sorts of projectile missile. Look out here, cameraman, you can see down into the beautiful town from here really well. Obviously ignore the industrial bit behind it. Why is this last tower closed off then? Oh, it's nice and warm out here now. I'm expecting a drop of some sort. No, just damaged stairs and a lot of pigeon shit. But there would have been a time where you could have walked up and stood at the top features there. You see, absolutely magnificent. Problems with any siege is supplies. This looks suspiciously like it was the well. So here we see all the way down. Come over here and hang over, cameraman, and you'll see down there an elaborate ornament which looks like it was the well. So the people under siege actually had plenty of water, but it was food. They didn't come out the way. There's some people here. And it wasn't like you could just start cannibalizing people. Once you started starving, that was it. There's nothing you can do about it. And another thing that people would do would be to launch dead animals, as well as fire, over the top of the tower in an effort to spread disease, which would happen, so that by the time that you got through the gate, the people were already suffering or weak. So biological warfare was in use long before the modern military tactics we know today. Another interesting point to consider as well is how much of our history is rewritten for the sake of other people, and sometimes it can match an internationalist idea. Sometimes the history that we're offered pleases modern minds far more than it would one seeking actual historical information. And that's why I always like to look a little deeper myself, and I can't advise enough that you do as well, because quite often the stories that we're given, even if they're by your favourite historians or documentarians, quite often they might either be giving you the nicer version or the tall tale version, which doesn't really paint the true depictions of us and our history.
Parliamentarian military members have been accused of vandalism in here. Previously there was what we refer to as graffiti, where the illiterate members of the population would be able to learn aspects of the gospel, of the Bible, via physical depictions. But the parliamentarian armies at the time actually damaged some of these relics and some of the graffiti. For the friars, the monks, all sorts of influential people, the clerisy and related intelligentsia, basically ladies and gentlemen, would have their homes and perform their ceremonies. No, the castle is dating back to 300 AD, and this is 600 AD, so around about 300 years after the very first edifices of the fortress by the Romans was constructed, this here was also constructed.
Hold your cane. Come on.
These are great. This would have once led upstairs.
Why is that door closed?
Thank you.
Actually brought this down here is, as I said before, we was going to go to London to look for a, or to strike one of the pubs of historical interest. But then I was sitting with Alex and I thought, you know what, why don't we get on the train, come all the way out here, because it's not that difficult, and come and see Rochester, which I enjoyed once when I was working nearby. And as I was working, I was always waiting for the day that I would be able to finish the job and then have a look around. So I had a look around, I was trying to learn on site, but you can't really do that. So that's why it was always due every visit. So, ladies and gentlemen, the reason why Rochester Cathedral is of such historical and cultural significance and importance is specifically because King Ethelbert was the very first king of Kent and of England who was baptized a Christian from a pagan after multiple deliberations between the political and social elite of the time. So, basically, this here is the seat whereby paganism was absolved and Christendom took the forefront. As you can see here, the site of the Saxon Cathedral, built by Ethelbert, King of Kent, AD 604, the line of the apse is marked inside the cathedral. What? Not sure what apse is, do please pardon my ignorance. But suffice it to say, as if you were a cultural or historical or monarchical hegemon, you would want to be baptized and all related ceremonies either happen in Rochester Cathedral or Canterbury Cathedral. And many processions and ceremonies by the priesthood and monarchic intelligentsia were held either in this year cathedral or... This place has been a seat for monarchic and clerical hierarchy and power throughout the centuries. This is why it is eyebrow-raising and intriguing, and it deserves a fixated look upon its history due to the degree of exaggerations and superfluous additions to the stories and histories of the Reformation and the English Civil War. Suffice it to say, this place is of monumental historical significance and ought to be preserved with the utmost care, dignity, and valuation for that which is past that we can enjoy during the present. On that note, thank you very much for listening. Till next time.